So walk me through a little bit of that time and how Aaron came to be in the band.
So when you guys let Aaron go, Aaron hit me, you know, we were already buds, and he knew that we needed a fill-in because our fill-in drummer, he only had like one more tour. We did like the Korn 20th anniversary tour with Suicide Silence and Korn, and we were going to bring him in on that one to start filling in, but we already had our other dude, Joe Rickard. I don't know if you know him or not. He does a lot of production work. He played drums in the band Red.
I've never met him.
And yeah, he's a really good guy. So yeah, after that Korn tour, I hit up Aaron and I was just like, hey, we're some headline shows. Would you be cool to fill in? He was like, yeah, sure, I'll do it. So he started filling in. And it just kind of from there. And I think what was weird, kind of strange, because we knew that Aaron came from a band that was in a bus. He had his own bedroom. I had been back there before. He was showing me his room and everything on the bus. And I remember just like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. And then he went from that to driving our van. And I just want to say this about Aaron. Aaron never, he never let it get to him, or at least he didn't show it to us. He never complained about the fact that we were in a van. He always just looked at it like, hey, like, let's, you know, we're building something new. And, I'm just grateful to be a part of something that you guys are passionate about. And so I just thought that that was really cool that, he just, you know, a lot of people couldn't do that. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. I don't think a lot of people could go from being in one of the biggest bands in the world. Not to give you a big head, but you guys are one of the biggest fans in the world. And, you know, to jumping in a van, a smelly van, and him driving the van most of the time and never complaining about it. If there's anything that I can say about Aaron, it's, that was really cool. That was really
cool. Guys let him drive? You guys let Aaron Elihai drive that van most of the time?
Yeah.
You guys are braver than I thought.
Dude, yeah, man. He was a good driver, dude. He was a pretty good driver. He would, he actually, there was a times he would put on the Hail to the King record and he would like play on the steering wheel to it, you know, like the whole, we would ask him questions. We would always be like, what's it like playing with fire, Aaron? Get to play with fire.
I want to be in those rooms just to hear what his answers would be. Because I'm thinking about it. I mean, we have nothing but love for Aaron. It just worked out creatively differently. But the man and the player that he is, you know, always have great things to say about Aaron. He's a good guy. Yeah. Played nicely for us, just creatively. We weren't on the same page at the same time. So, but I'm glad that he was able to.
I feel that. We
go ahead.
I was gonna say that's the same kind of thing with us. Aaron did quit. We didn't let him go like that, but I do remember there were times where he started wanting more to play guitar instead of the drums. And we were like, dude, you're such a good drummer. And we don't have another drummer for the drums. But no, I mean, at the time,
he's a good guitar player, though. I remember
he
picked up the acoustic guitar while he was with us and the guitar in general while he's out with us and would play some stuff with Brian Sinister Gates on the bus and days off. Brian was teaching him some gypsy jazz chords so he could play the rhythms, and then Brian was working on all of his gypsy jazz solo stuff. I would always ask them to play me some songs when they're hanging out in the hotel room or bus. I'd say I'd make requests.
Oh yeah, there were many times where we were having cookouts and stuff in the recording of the Power Under Control record, and we were staying at Aaron's house actually in the garage. I'm trying to think like a good way to explain it. I don't know. They just made the whole garage. It didn't feel like a garage. It felt kind of like this like hippie pad. And it was just nice. Like they had blankets everywhere and these awesome mattresses that were just so comfy. And so it was kind of an inspiring place to be while we were recording the record. And he would play gypsy jazz a lot when we were doing like cookouts or whatever.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, he made himself like a little bonus room, a little rec room in the out of the garage.
Yeah.
Kind of vibe. Yeah. That's cool, man. I didn't realize. So he left the band, and when was that? After that cycle, or were you guys? Did you guys finish out that cycle with Aaron?
We were almost finished with the cycle, but we had. I think we were in Virginia when he quit. It wasn't like I quit. It was more like we all had a conversation, and he was just in a spot to be home with his wife, and they had just had a baby, so that was really fresh. And I never was upset with him about it or anything or mad. I just was going to be hard to replace Aaron. He's an amazing drummer, and I didn't want the next drummer to come in and be like, that guy was in Avenged Sevenfold. How do I compete with this? And it's like, no, dude, like I feel that way because every person that's ever played with us has been dope. So it's just Aaron played with fire before. That's all.
Figuratively and literally, I guess, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But you, like I mentioned, though, you guys had met up quite a bit on the Mayhem tour, I remember as well. You mentioned that he showed his room. I have to correct on that. His room on the bus. yeah, yes. That's a. We had star coaches, and we've had him in the past, and there is a room back there. But it's shared. I don't want him to. I don't want him to get a big head and be like, oh yeah, this is my room and my bus. You know, no, Aaron. No.
I thought it was his room only, bro.
I say that in all teasing. You know, it is. It is fun. Yeah. I don't remember what the bus situation was. We had star coaches, and we'd all be on different buses and stuff and everything. But, so, I mean, what were some of your first impressions with him on that Mayhem tour? I know that you were hanging out, as you mentioned, the guys with Korn as well, and O'Brien and Fieldy. You guys were out hanging pretty often when you weren't on stage, you know. So what were some of your first impressions, and again, how that made it seamless to have him fill in?
My first impressions were he was really down to earth as far as he didn't come across like, I don't know, people like they could come across as big shots or whatever, and he never did that. It was just kind of like, hey, like I come watch your set, and yeah, and he was like, all right, well, like, walk down the hall to, you know, make sure you're out of the way. Because one time I was standing in the hallway and I like waved to Aaron, and Big T was like, back up. And Aaron was like, I'll talk to you after. And like, it was just funny because we were ropes. We were just like, I don't know. Like, are we allowed to go watch them on stage, side stage or whatever? It was cool. But as far as like hanging out with Fieldy and Brian, we were having it sounds like such a like a cultish, like weird, like seance thing. We were having Bible studies every once in a while on that tour. And so we were meeting up, and we believe some of the same things for the most part. We were just encouraging one another, and we weren't in there plotting to take Mayhem out there and be like, you're gonna know about Jesus. Like, no, like it was literally just, you know, there were some of us that were like, oh, like it's kind of like finding somebody else who likes WCW or WWF at the time. It was like, oh, let's connect. Like,
yeah.
So for any of those that don't know wrestling stuff.
Oh, don't worry. We're getting into the wrestling stuff, and probably right.
I was going to say, I hope we're going to talk about that.
Oh no, that's the coup de grace of the conversation here. I just wanted to make sure we mentioned our mutual friend, Aaron. Do you stay in contact with him much?
I don't talk to him much. And again, that's not on purpose or anything. Right. Every once in a while, we've sent each other memes and stuff. If I see what he's doing online, as far as in his life, like I'll like it. He sent me encouragement before and stuff like that. So in no way do I want people to think like, because we don't text every day, we don't have a lot of love for each other. It's just, we're both doing, you know, our own thing. He's got a family. He's got stuff he's working on, and I'm still out here hustling and grinding, and this van should be driving, but you know.
Well, I love it. All love to Aaron Hill. I honestly, good guy, good mutual friend here.